Back on the team top prospect lists and really farm system rundowns here on the call up. I'm Aram Layton. He's Jack McMullen. We're talking New York Mets today, and we are now officially on the back half of the final 30. Like we were talking about checking off every single team top prospect list. We're finally on the back half of the 30. So now this is the 16th that we've done, 14 more to go. But the New York Mets, it's a fun time to talk about them because I would argue that this is as good of a Mets farm system as we've seen in a while. And there's a concerted effort to build that farm. We saw that through the trades of Justin Verlander, Max Scherzer, and others, adding that money on top to get better prospects. And I think they've done a really good job in that regard. And then we're seeing kind of a change in lower level scouting with some of the trades that they were able to make, getting a Jeremy Rodriguez for Tommy Pham, who we'll talk about. Like, there's a tangible change in this Mets organization. One, the focus from the top of, hey, I understand the importance of a farm system, but two, putting in the people, you know, in the right places to scout better, develop better, and draft better. And I think it's the early stages, but you're seeing, I think, a change in the way the Mets farm system is going to be run, I think, for the next few years. And this is kind of the first year where we can really highlight that.
For sure. They were certainly a bottom half farm system before last deadline. I will say that, but they added three of the top five in here right now, or three of the top six. I think three of the top five at the deadline. And it did turn into pay to play, right? Like, you know, they move Verlander and money in order to get a good prospect return. They move Scherzer and money in order to get Luisangel Acuna. But you can appreciate their emphasis on getting guys for 6 years when we have, since ownership changed, branded the Mets as the team that doesn't care about paying a guy $750,000. Like, they'd rather pay a guy that's slightly better $15 million if it means that they're going to win a couple more games. That's not how good organizations are built. Good organizations are a healthy mix of putting their chips forward, like their literal chips, their money forward when they need to, but also growing talent to complement that. And I think for the first time in a little bit, we're seeing the complementary talent be grown in the minor leagues for the New York Mets.
Yeah, I think you got it perfect there, where I think Steve Cohen came in first year. And I think this was probably always part of the plan. He's a smart guy. He's probably analyzing the best teams and seeing what they do. And he's a baseball fan. And but I think he probably felt that they could spend their way to success that first year a little bit more than, and they had a good year, but a little bit easier than maybe it is when you start to live it, and realizing sustainable success comes from building the depth of that farm. And it was cool to see Cohen legitimately talk about the farm on several occasions. You don't see owners say, oh, we got to replenish the farm. Like, we need to make, you know, build a better farm system infrastructure and player development infrastructure as well. You'll hear that occasionally, but it would seem to be a very important point for Steve Cohen. And I think they're already starting to see the results of that. And how often do you see teams willing to throw in more money to get prospects? Usually it's the other way around. I'm throwing in prospects to have more money saved. So that's the other side is, yeah, you know, it is a pay to play thing, but it's refreshing to see pay to play for the farm system and sustainable success instead of just, hey, yeah, let's throw money at a guy that's going to be marginally better than, you know, a guy that we could probably plug in at the minimum.
Well, and the other thing is, yes, they had a successful, you know, first go at it trying to pay to win games, but look at who they finished behind in the division. Like, they finished behind a team that IDs guys and pays them up front when they excel on the league minimum in their first 2 years. So I bet Steve Cohen looked at what was happening with there's not another owner over there. I guess it's just Liberty Media. I view them as like kind of an abstract thought, the Braves ownership, like the Atlanta Braves Foundation. But, you know, like, if they were in my division, I'd be looking at them being like, okay, so you're telling me that I don't need to fork over a $300 million contract to be the wagon of the NL East? Let's try and figure out a creative way to do this.
100%. And then you can look at the Dodgers and say you can kind of do both. And then just hope you can take it across the finish line. But we'll jump right into it. Of course, as always, the article is linked in the episode description. But if you want to follow along on YouTube, of course, we have that up on the screen now. And we'll fly through the names to watch, Jack. This was actually Ryan Finkelstein, our managing editor, chipping in here on the names to watch. And obviously he's the Mets extraordinaire, also hosts Locked On Mets. It's the best Mets podcast out there. So I know he was really excited to get involved with this. So how do you want to do the names to watch? You want to just kind of, you want to still walk us through them? And Sure. And I'll fill in.
Sure. Yeah. Ryan booted me. He was me for this yes. article. So he edited 1 through 15 and he did the names to watch, but he highlighted some really interesting names. Jacob Reimer is an interesting one as well. This is a guy that, you know, is probably plan C at the hot corner. It's probably Beatty is plan A, a free agent is plan B. And then Reimer, you know, is a far ways off, but it feels like they've been starved for third base talent since David Wright. I remember when Ryan wrote a great article about that and kind of hoping that Beatty was the next coming. He's not going to be David Wright, but Beatty can be a good big leaguer. And Reimer is a good contingency plan that's pretty far away in high A. Cade Morris, pitchability guy. He was Nevada Wolf Pack? He was a Wolf in the Wolf Pack. But he's low to mid-90s. It's kitchen sink type thing. It's probably ceiling of back-end starter and floor of AAA starter that could get the call up at the very last moment.
Yeah, you know, I'm always interested in these types because, you know, all of a sudden you tick up to 94, 95. We're just talking about Quinn Matthews the other day with the Cardinals. Yeah. Like, then all of a sudden there's a little bit more there. But, you know, definitely a high probability big league arm in some capacity. And, you know, I like the way that he can mix it up and throw strikes. Reimer, by the way, is hurt, unfortunately, because I was actually interested to see what he's going to do this year. Really good feel to hit. The question is there going to be enough power there now that he's moved to the hot corner? And we'll see. First, he needs to get healthy, but there was a clear feel to hit there that was decently impressive. So he's definitely intriguing and probably was on the edge of the top 15.
Yeah. Next guy is Yoander Suarez, who's in Double A Binghamton right now. I'll be honest. I would see Jay Suarez on the probables and I didn't tune in because frankly, the baseball reference page does not look good. But yeah. Yoander Suarez is a guy that's been around for a long time. I think he's a 24-year-old in Double A right now. And, you know, we'll see what happens this year. I think Ryan says in here, you know, flash in the pan in a brief showing in Double A after he really was not that great in high A, an ERA over 5 in 90 innings. So I've got no idea what to expect from Yoander Suarez, but I guess this is the year to monitor him. And if not, you know, might be time to jump ship.
This was a Fink special. I think he's interested because, well, the first outing, Suarez went 5 shutty, 6 punch outs, then followed that up with a pretty good one. Again, you know, 4 2/3, 2 earned runs, 4 punch outs. So, I mean, he's been around for a little bit, but there were some stretches last year. High A, he punched out 11 in one outing of 6 scoreless. So I think with some of the flashes, and I think it was the way that he closed out last year that had Mets fans pretty excited. So to close out last year the way that he did and then start this year the way that he has, I think that's pretty fascinating. He ended the year last year on a 24-inning scoreless streak. So, you know, that's whether, you know, I know he's 23 in high A for most of that year, but that was through Double A. So 3 of those 4 starts on that streak were in Double A. And then he followed that up with 5 more scoreless in his first start this year. So maybe something clicked there. He was throwing a little bit harder at the end of last year too. So that might be a little uptick that could be enough to make him a big league arm in some capacity.
Yeah. Next guy is Tyler Stewart, who's fascinating because he was older for the level when it comes to prospects. He was a 23-year-old in high A last year that absolutely dominated. I think it was 1.55 in 75 2/3 innings in high A. He goes up to Double A for a brief cameo. I think it was, 7 starts? He had a 3.6 ERA. So he rode the hot hand. He's in Double A. He had a rough go of it in his first start. He went 4 2/3, 9 hits, but, you know, limited it to 3 earned. But 3 earned and 4 2/3 is not great. Tyler Stewart, I would like to see be pushed to a place where he is a year or more younger than the league average, you know, pitcher. Like, because it feels like he has worked on a track that is normal for an organizational guy that might get a shot.
Yeah,
I think he's better than that. And the reason I think he's better than that is because he really doesn't allow homers. This guy, I think it was 110 innings last year. He allowed 7 home runs. He really doesn't get hit with the long ball. It would take paper cuts to beat him. And that's why he was so good against hitters in high A that were probably selling out for juice.
Yeah, he's 6'9". And big it's boy. Like, you know, that high downward, heavy fastball, kind of sinker, gets a fair amount of ground balls. And as you mentioned, keeps them all in the yard. I mean, when you're 6'9" and have, you know, a fastball that can get up to the mid-90s and can kind of create unique angles, like, I'm always going to be interested. It's just, yeah, it's been interesting to see how they've kind of treated him. I agree. Kind of I wouldn't say he's gotten the full org guy label, but he's been handled in an org adjacent way. Yeah. I don't think that they think that of him because I think they're also aware that he's a 6'9 righty that has flashed some really good things. But I'm with you. I think when Christian Scott gets promoted, that might be the time where that AAA spot in the rotation could open up for Stewart.
And we're going to get into that Syracuse rotation because that Syracuse rotation is really good.
Jesus
Baez, the next guy in Palm Beach, very underwhelming. Or St. Lucie, sorry, the St. Lucie Mets. The Palm Beach Cardinals, the St. Lucie Mets. That Florida State League is tough for me. But Jesus Baez, another guy, really not great when he came over at the complex. 210, 306, 333 slash. Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting to watch a whole year, but this is a guy that I think they paid a good bit of money to that just hasn't really hit the ground running.
Yeah, it was interesting because, you know, I was watching him hit and it didn't look bad at all. Like I was expecting, whenever you see those numbers at the complex, you're like, oh, there's going to be some.
There's going to be a hole or something. Yeah.
It really wasn't that bad. I think it was just a little bit of quality of contact here and there. I think sometimes just putting the ball on the ground a bit too much. And I still, though, I was surprised to see how bad the numbers were. And if you look at some of the underlying, even it was pretty good. And that's why, you know, when you look at the start to this year and kind of what he's doing in the early going in low A, I think there's reason to be cautiously optimistic. I thought the underlying stuff was pretty good overall last year. And now through 11 games this year, slashing 271, 327, 479. But what's most impressive to me is even with those bad numbers last year, he didn't strike out a lot. He was patient, walked plenty. And this year it's been the same story so far. It's very early, but four walks, four Ks. Contact rate is impressive. And I know, again, it's small samples, but it's all we have to work with right now. 82% overall contact rate, 93% within the zone. Like, this guy's got a good feel for the barrel. He just turned 19. I'm intrigued. I'm willing to kind of put that first, you know, 18 years old, first pro season, mm-hmm. really at the complex, like kind of to the side and give him a fresh look this year. And so far, it's been pretty good. And he's actually hit the ball pretty hard, too. Already posted some EVs as high as 106, 107. There might even be a 108 sprinkled in there. Like, you know, he's not a big dude. So I'm interested.
Okay, next one's for you. Why is Kevin Parada not a top 15 prospect?
Okay. Is he like top 15 elsewhere? Is he like consensus top 15 in the system still?
I don't know. Let me look at some of the other
publications. Because I'm just curious. But regardless, here's my trouble with Kevin Parada. And he's off to a decent start, and I hope he continues it. I'm really struggling because when we rank these guys, it's also what role do they fit into on a 40-man roster and a 26-man roster, you know, in the active roster when they get there. And that's, I mean, how these teams are looking at it is, you know, what is that future role going to look like? Kevin Parada swings and misses a ton. Early going to this year, he's been much more patient, which is huge because he was super aggressive last year as well. So big swing and miss, very aggressive. He does hit the ball hard. 105 mile per hour, 90th percentile. We saw the power numbers that he put up at Georgia Tech. Like, we know that he can hit the ball hard and we know that he elevates. So there's above average power potential in there, no doubt. The problem for me is he's not a great defensive catcher. I'd say he's below average defensively. The arm isn't great. So you have below average defense behind the dish at this point, or at least even getting to the point where it's, you could maybe say it's within arm's length of average at the best case. But then you have an offensive profile that comes with a ton of whiff, like not good contact rates, an approach that was not great. And again, I just did not really see him hit the ball hard with consistency last year. He'd run into his, but that's about it. So limited defensively, doesn't give you much value as a catcher. Very high whiff, you know, low end hit tool type of guy. With, you know, let's hope the approach gets better. I won't, you know, dock him as much for that. But what's that role? Like, the role I see is like a part-time catcher, part-time first base DH platoon type that crushes lefties. Like, I don't see an everyday catcher here when he's going to strike out a ton. And I'm worried that he might not hit enough at all. And then you also don't have much defensive, if any defensive value there too. Like, what is he giving you behind the dish then at that point? It's kind of Joey Bart-ish at this point. And that's kind of a concern.
That's a big concern. He is really a consensus top 10 guy, I'd say, elsewhere. Like, he's number 9 in pipeline. I think BA had him at 10. The Athletic had him at 9. Fangraphs hasn't updated their list yet, but like he did not crack a list of imminent big leaguers. So he's in like the 9-10 range. But if there's minimal defensive value there and the bat is not, you know, along the lines of, hey, he can be a big league DH, like that's not a top 10 prospect in a system. I don't think.
And I think we're really leaning into the where he was drafted. I think that's been a big part of it. And even in the early going this year, man, base Steelers are 11 for 12.
That's unacceptable.
And it's just, I look at the arm. I'm more like when it's harder to hold guys on, you need guys that are really quick and have a really strong arm. I try not to hold the caught stealing numbers against guys too much because of all the variables that go into minor league baseball. But you know, I see a lot of like where Joey Bart is now and Kevin Parada, and it might even be a little bit worse because there's not as much raw power. So again, I'm just, you know, Mets fans may push back on that one. I get it. But when you have a high chase rate last year, again, it's really good to see him cutting down on that because that will help a lot, take some pressure off of the lack of field to hit. But when you have a low-end hit tool, you have above-average power, and you are a below-average defender, a catcher, even if that gets too fringy, is that a top 10 prospect in a pretty good system? Like, no. I don't think so to me.
No. A couple other guys in the names to watch here. I think you've made the case perfectly. Ronald Hernandez and Marco Vargas both came back in the David Robertson trade. Neither is top 15 right now, but they're both probably top 20, I'd assume. Mm-hmm. The fact that they got two top 20 prospects for a guy that crapped the bed for the Miami Marlins, this is a heist by the Mets.
That wouldn't have been a trade that Peter Bendix made, I can tell you that. Ronald Hernandez can actually be a well-rounded catcher. I would have Hernandez ahead of Kevin Parada at this point.
So
Hernandez is almost 2.5 years younger. I think has a little bit more defensive potential there. And I, you know, Hernandez has some defensive questions too, but I think being younger, you can always dream on a little bit more, better field to hit at his age. And I think a little bit better of an approach. Switch hitter. I like Hernandez. I'm really interested. And I even think that if it doesn't work out behind the dish, there might be enough to dream on there with the bat. He's been off to a pretty good start this year in low A, 808 OPS. Let's see if he can elevate a little bit more. But obviously, you know, in that Florida State League, your power is going to be suppressed. Marco Vargas was interesting because, you know, that was the better prospect at the time in the trade. And I probably would still have him ahead. I was not happy that the Marlins had moved Marco Vargas in a deal for a David Robertson. But I'm pretty surprised at, you know, how Vargas struggled after the trade. We've talked about it. It's not entirely uncommon, even when players stick at the same level, to just struggle after a trade, seeing a lot of new arms, getting thrown into a new environment. A lot of times these kids are young and like
and moving it's, parts it's, too. It's like, wait, you're telling me I have to pack my life up and be somewhere else in 48
hours? I think people forget that you go straight to the Fangraphs page and you're like, well, what the heck? It's still high A. Like Edwin Arroyo was another one of those where it's like, what do you mean? Like he was putting up great numbers and it's the same, you know, it's the same type of competition.
He's trying to There's make a lot of variables. Friends. Like, yeah, shit's hard.
Yeah, these guys are young. And I think that was a big part of it for Vargas. He's not even 19 years old yet. Fantastic field to hit. I think he's hurt right now. I'm not sure the degree of it, but he hasn't played since the 11th. I think he ultimately moves to second base. I think this could still grow into a plus hit tool. If he can get anywhere close to average power out of that frame, then I think you could see an everyday second baseman there. Overall, the numbers were still really good last year. I thought he really showed some great things in the complex. It's a really smooth swing. It's a really advanced approach. I wouldn't be surprised if Vargas has a nice stretch this year, so young, that he could end up cracking that top 10. I'm still expecting him to climb pretty quickly, I think, in these farm system rankings.
Got you. And then the last name to watch is Nolan McLean, who has some prospect pedigree now. After an interesting spring breakout, he looked phenomenal on the mound. And that breaking ball that he was throwing, you've got a 3,000 RPM slider in here. I mean, he was throwing incredibly hard, and then he was complimenting the slider off that. He's a righty exclusive, or if he's a pitcher exclusive, this guy, like when he leans into it, could really take off, it seems.
I think so. But the funny thing is, Ryan Finkelstein keeps sending me videos of Nolan McLean hitting home runs. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, dude, I get it. He can run into homers, but I really want him to focus on pitching. I can't lie, though. He's been swinging it pretty well. They throw him in like a DH role, you know, I think a couple of times a week. He's been striking out a ton. I don't see it ultimately in terms of him being like an everyday hitter. It's just not there. The hit tool is just not good enough. I legitimately, out of the draft, I'm pretty sure I put like a 20 on that. Like it was not a good hit tool presently. That said, could you have like a unique reliever pinch hitter situation here? I will say, like, we've seen a couple of situations, like Scott McGough the other day, because of they depleted the whole bench on the D-backs. Like, he ended up having to hit, and with the bases loaded, two outs.
He struck out looking. Yeah, he left the bat on his shoulder.
It was not a strike in his defense, but yes. Yeah. I mean, McLean, you're letting him go in that situation. It's very rare, but, you know, he could be that last option power bat pinch hitter that they allow. It's interesting that they're letting him hit. Here to talk about the pitching, though, I would love to see him just focusing on that more. And I think even naturally as he is, like, even still hitting a little bit, he is focusing more on pitching than he ever has. I think there's some characteristics that make him almost guaranteed to be a seventh inning guy at the very least. When you look at the 3,000 RPM slider, but then the fastball from a 5-3 release in the mid-90s that I think if he's going 1 to 2 inning spurts can get up to probably the upper 90s as he continues to, you know, throw harder and kind of just get used to that pitcher's workload. Mixes in a hard cutter. The changeup's a work in progress. They're going to give him every shot to start, and I'm not going to rule that out because he is a good athlete on the mound, and the fastball is good, and the slider is good. And you know, I think he can get whiffs on both and has some flashes of third and fourth pitches. But I love the floor of McLean, which is a really solid two-pitch, you know, seventh inning guy that could even be a higher leverage guy. And then who knows? Maybe you can have a little moment where he pinch hits here and there.
Got you.
All right, so this was kind of an 11th hour shakeup here, Jack, at number 15 with Jonah Tong, right-handed pitching prospect in low A. And I did highlight him recently in the bonus episode. I also highlighted him in the pitching prospect roundup that we're going to do every – you can find the pitching prospect roundups, by the way, on justbaseball.com every Tuesday. And I'm going to be doing hitting prospect roundups every Monday. Really just people that are standing out to me that I think are worth your attention, not just heat sheets, you know, and make it a little bit more unique and kind of clue you into some people that are getting our attention. Yeah. Tong is one of those guys because he was drafted in the seventh round in 2022 as kind of a project. Another Canadian guy that the Mets seem to kind of like digging into the arms out there. We're going to get to another one in a moment, unfortunately. Not as much positive to say from a health perspective. But with Tong, that was just the fastball characteristics that I think made the Mets really interested, as well as an intriguing curveball. And right away, we saw it last year in pro ball where he was averaging 20 inches of vert. It was 90, 91, maybe occasional 92, but he was averaging 20 to 21 inches of vert. So that's always going to be intriguing. It's that over the top release really backspins it. Then he emerges this year, and in his first start, averaged 92.5. So that's about a tick and a half up from what we saw last year. And goes without saying, with 20 inches of vert, a tick and a half harder, you're going to overpower some guys. And not only did he do that in that first outing, he also really mixed in a slider that started to look like it could be at least an average pitch, and then still has that hammer curveball that looks like it's an above average pitch as well. Then his last outing, he threw even harder. Fastball average 93, but he touched 96 for the first time and then touched 97. So throwing even harder after throwing the most pitches in your professional career, which was the last outing, throwing even more pitches the second outing and averaging a half tick higher and touching, you know, multiple ticks higher than we've ever seen you touch with the same characteristics on the fastball and a slider that he's added to the equation. Jonah Tong has got our attention, I think, man.
If you like playing the extrapolation game, this is the guy. Like, everybody's doing it with Skeens right now where he's got 19 punchouts and 9 1/3. Do you know Tong's like standard numbers off the dome?
I'll tell you right now if you don't. I do know he has 21 punchies?
21 punchies in how many innings?
It should be 11.
8 1/3.
Oh, wow.
8 1/3, 21 punchouts, 5 walks.
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. Like, you want to play the extrapolation game. He's a young Kerry Wood. I think that's really cool that he's got like the fastball curveball combination. I think the fastball curveball arm is becoming not a lost art. That just sounds old heady, but it's becoming more and more rare because you've got guys that want to do fastball slider all the time. the north-south aspect of that, mixing in a slider for east-west, is awesome. Like, it's something that is unique now, will keep guys off balance, and a good breaking ball and a good curveball plays off of a fastball like that so ridiculously well. And if that velo continues to increase, that'll make the curveball actually even better if he can tunnel and look the exact same. Like, that's the type of profile that makes a ton of sense, even in short spurts.
You don't get those over-the-top guys as much anymore. And you want that curveball over the top. And I think of like a Nick Pivetta. Pivetta found a slider, and that's helped him. But the slider is not his most devastating pitch. It could be that curveball, honestly, when he's on with it, from that same release point over the top, that really – the same way we talk about sliders playing up, because so many guys want to go high three quarters because it gives you a lower release point. And sliders are going to play off of that.
And it's dependent on the slot, man. Like that was the sweeper revolution. Everybody's throwing from a three-quarter, low three-quarter, and like, hey, the sweeper plays way better instead of like a true curveball from there.
Exactly. And so that's why a lot of those guys struggle with the curveball. And if you don't have the changeup, then it's hard to find that third pitch. With Tong, you know, it was okay. Is he going to be able to throw a slider? Because I like the 75 mile an hour downer curveball that tunnels off of a riding fastball like that. But you can't rely on a pitch like that. You know, 20 mile per hour, 15 mile per hour separation. Guys can start to get a little bit comfortable with that sequence. And even if it does tunnel, start to shut anything down that starts, you know, at basically waist high or below. So having something that's horizontal to mix in there, it doesn't even need to be great. And it seems like it's good, but he has a lot of confidence in it. And he's been throwing it more than his curveball so far. I think Tong could be a guy that ends up also. You know, guys are going to graduate. But I also think he's someone that, you know, if that command tracks closer to 45, I just couldn't comfortably put a command grade on right now, because you look at last year, the command was a little bit spotty. He hasn't walked a ton so far this year, but it's mostly been because anytime he falls behind in the count, he just goes back to the fastball.
It's
60% whiff in the zone right now and a 22% swinging strike rate. So he can just kind of blow by you. But I'm excited. I think this is an arm that the Mets, you know, Mets fans should be pumped about. And I don't think it's overreacting through two starts to say, hey, I want to keep tabs on this guy.
Yeah.
14 is, unfortunately, right before we recorded this, Calvin Ziegler, it came out that he is going to need to undergo Tommy John surgery, which is a just terrible blow for a guy that came out of the gate looking so good. He threw one inning last year, coming off of what was an elbow procedure to clean up some bone fragments. And then while he was rehabbing, tore his quad. So made it back at the very end of the year to throw one inning. Was so good out of the gate this year. We saw six innings, I believe, and he punched out, what was it? Like 12? Did not allow a run. And then now the news that he's undergoing Tommy John. This was a guy that I could guarantee stuff-wise could go into a big league bullpen, but even was showing enough to say, hey, like maybe this could be a swingman type, a five and dive if it all really works out. But it's a fastball that I think could be better than plus, a curveball that's plus, and a slider that he was mixing in here and there and working on. Second round pick in 2021, you can see why. And it just feels like Matt Allen all over again with the Mets, which is really unfortunate. The good news is he's still just 21. He'll get back and, you know, he'll be 23, you know, by the time he comes back. But I think they can push him, you know, with relative aggressiveness. But it's just, I feel so bad for this kid.
It's just like, it's a crappy story. And like, there's nobody now that I'm really rooting for harder in the minor leagues than a guy like this. And it's similar, you know, higher profile because this guy was a top 10 pick, but Jake Berger, when Berger tore his Achilles and then ruptured his surgically repaired Achilles during rehab. Like, that was one of those guys that I think was universally being cheered on as he was making his way to the big leagues. And that is going to be Ziegler now. And, you know, it's not an empathy thing. It is an empathy thing. It's not a, I feel bad for you, I want to throw you a bone and get you to the big leagues thing. You know how good they are and how good they can be. And you just want to see 80% of that. So Ziegler has been dealt a terrible hand the last year and a half, 2 years. I feel for him so badly, and I'm going to be rooting really hard as he works his way back from TJ and tries to climb through the minor leagues. And, you know, if they do try to turn him into a one inning guy, he could strike out the world
And he can fly up and make up for lost time. And, the good news is, like, you know, the elbow procedure to remove the fragments and stuff is usually pretty minor. You know, that's not really a major, like, you're not changing anything physically too much. And then the quad is just a fluky thing. So I feel like you get the Tommy John healed up. Maybe that could be where he can finally kind of turn the page and go from there. And that's what I'm hoping for with Ziegler. But, you know, I still think he will be a big leaguer. I do believe that. Yeah. 13. Yeah, that was added to the 40 man despite a rough year last year. Alex Ramirez, outfielder in Double A, off to a pretty good start. There was a story about how he opted to pretty much train at the complex in the Dominican, the Mets complex, like all off season. And, you know, no one made him do it kind of thing was the story. Like, he just really wanted to do it to work on shortening his swing and trying to make more contact. Yeah. It looks better. I've always been a skeptic of Alexander Ramirez, but that was relative to, like, he was on top 100 list and stuff. Yeah. And I just never really got that. But I can understand why the Mets added him to the 40-man roster. And I can understand why people see a big league role here. I see a big league role here. That's why he's a top 15 guy in the system. That role is probably a fourth outfielder that gives you flashes of some exciting stuff. I don't know if the defense is going to be as good as like a Jake Marisnik, but I think there can be some similarities there where, like, he gets hot and he hits balls hard. I mean, this guy can hit the ball hard. He's 6'2", long levers, though. He had a home run the other day, 108, like, dead center, or I think it was a double off the top of the wall, but 108 dead center, 410 feet. He went oppo for a home run, 107. To go 107 oppo on a 95 mile an hour fastball, like, he's got some freaky stuff to him. He's a great defender in the outfield. He's a plus runner, but I just think the swing is too long. Ultimately, sliders are going to chew him up. The plate discipline's not great. I think ultimately there's just going to be too much whiff. But the one thing that I've seen that has changed is hitting fastballs well. And if he's just a guy that crushes fastballs and plays elite defense, he can be a fourth outfielder. And I think he can do that. But, you know, I think the stat line may be a little bit misleading. If you see 343, 368, 543, you can also see a 65% ground ball rate, struggles with secondaries and things like that. I do still think that there's a fourth outfielder role for him here as he continues to shorten up the swing. And talk about prospect fatigue. He just turned 21.
Yeah, like young 21 in Double A at this point. So that's just the immediate counter whenever you may raise concerns. It's like, okay, he's a 21 in Double and, like, he's off to the hot start. I understand, like, ground balls are elevated and all that. But that is, I guess, the counterpoint that can be presented is, hey, this guy's so young. I know that he's underperformed, but he's been so young at every level. At some point, you need to overperform your age at an advanced level. Like, that's the Kevin Alcantara thing that we talk about with the Cubs. Like, you know, we're waiting on that to come together. And Alex Ramirez is probably at the year where we want to see it come together at 21 years old in Double A. And that would be great.
Yeah, I don't know if it's ever going to come together totally offensively. And that's why I think, like,
to go, great defender, can run into some power. Like, yeah, fourth outfield, I
think that Marisnik comp is, like, kind of what could end up, you know, where he could kind of end up settling in. And, you know, that's a piece that matters, though. Like, you need those guys, and that's why they added him to the 40.
Yeah.
Number 12, Mike Vasil, right-handed pitching prospect in AAA. And this is where it gets fun because, you know, I think the Mets are one of those orgs where you can kind of, like, shuffle around some of these arms and say, like, oh, you know, which arm do you prefer of this group? And clearly, I'm going to walk you through which arms I prefer of the Mets grouping. And Vasil is on the bottom end of it for me, just because I don't think the stuff is going to be good enough to, I think, hold a rotation spot outside of, you know, being that innings eater five. That's my concern. And in the early going this year in AAA, it only kind of validated that. He's been getting teed off on pretty good. Slider's a good pitch. But you start to look beyond that, you know, it's a slider cutter that you can almost put into one pitch. He manipulates it into a harder cutter. And that's been playing like a plus pitch. He's got now he has a little bit more of a sweepier slider that can play as an above average pitch. But the fastball is fringy. The changeup is very inconsistent. The curveball is fringy. And the command is, I would say, average at best. Yeah. So to me, that's, you know, kind of a guy that's that plug and play starter, or that, you know, just kind of bulk relief guy. I just don't know if there's enough swing and miss here. And the command would need to be like plus to make this arsenal work as like a four starter. Maybe he could make it work enough to be a fringe five starter.
He's a guessing game guy that, you know, it throws in a bit more powerful of a way than most guessing game guys, because the whole point of Vasil's like attack is balance, right? It's he's balanced. The hitter is unbalanced. He wants to keep them on their heels. He can be on his toes and attack. And in order to be really good at that, and by really good at that, I mean like mid rotation starter at the major league level, you need to either throw 96 or you need to have great fastball shape. And the primary pitch is probably not good enough. Now, if he leans into the cutter thing, that could make things more interesting. But yeah, it's probably like five. And you just see higher ceiling with everybody else is what you're saying.
Exactly. And the prop, my one other aspect with Vasil is like, you know, you look at a Tidwell or you look at even Hamel, you can say, oh, well, that guy's stuff will play up in a pen.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can look at Vasil and say, oh,
that's a pen guy. He's a cleanup. You're down four in the fifth guy. Like, we need three innings.
And that's my concern, is like, I don't know if you have the fallback as much with Vasil. And then you're just kind of stuck with this, unfortunately, guy that's kind of going back and forth between AAA and the bigs and just kind of plugging and playing. That said, like Jose Buto was that guy, although Buto's always had a little bit better raw stuff and Buto's progressed. So, you know, Vasil's a big guy. Maybe he sees an uptick that would help. But, you know, being that he's already 24, I think he kind of is who he is. Maybe in a relief role, he just starts, like you said, leaning into a cutter more, and maybe he can succeed that way. But I think the best case scenario is that he can be that innings eater five. And I think it's possible, but he's got to find a little bit more command and find that change up a bit more as well.
Gotcha.
Number 11, not going to have too much on him, but just the what we've already been able to hear and what I've been able to see in limited video and just some of the people that do a good job scouting in the Dominican, just based on what I know, he's worth a flyer at 11. Yovanny Rodriguez, catcher, who should play in the DSL this year. More than half of the slot, like a bonus pool went to, or not slot bonus pool, but the international bonus pool went to Yovanny Rodriguez at $2.85 million in the 2023 class. I mean, when you, on paper, it sounds really good. Sub two pop times, above average EVs already. I saw some video rocket for an arm. And you look across the board and it's like, he's been a Venezuelan kid. These Venezuelan catchers have been really good in recent years. Yeah. It's been a lot of fun backstops coming out of there. And again, this is one where you kind of lean on some scouts that have been out there and have said some really good things about what they've seen from him. And then the video I've seen, I mean, the swing is definitely advanced for a teenager. You can definitely see physical build and running into some pop already. So you can dream on above average power, potentially an above average hit tool and above average defense. Again, emphasis on dream, but you can see all of the ingredients there. You got to do it in a game and in a professional setting and all that stuff. But I wouldn't be surprised if he hits the ground running in the DSL just off of the mechanics I've seen and the physical tools that I've seen. When I watch DSL video and he hasn't even played in the DSL yet, I don't see many catchers doing what he's doing. That's why I really liked Ramon Ramirez.
Okay.
I think there's some similarities there.
Got you. So I have nothing. I haven't watched a single video on this guy. What I will say is young Venezuelan backstops, Francisco Alvarez, Gabby Moreno, William Contreras, Jefferson Caro, like they know what they're doing. And you know, like that.
And those are all recent.
Those are all recent. And like, I'm not even mentioning big bro, William Wilson Contreras and, you know, Salvador Perez, those guys too. Like they are very, very good catchers. And, you know, I find that to be interesting.
Absolutely. I'm with you there. And you know, especially when it's a lot of these guys, there's overlap in the academies and things like that. Like, I don't always buy into like, oh, this guy's from the town of this, so he's going to do this. But when it's catching and, you know, there's so many intangibles and things that go into it, yeah, I do buy into it a little bit more.
Yeah.
getting into the top 10. And this is where we talk about how these arms kind of separate each other, you know, and or how they separate from others. Dominic Hamel is checking in at number 10. And this was fun for me to kind of separate and see, you know, what Hamel can do that Vasil can't, and why I think Hamel probably projects better at the big league level. And if you look at the pitch grades, it kind of leads you right into that answer already. Maybe the command's a little bit less, you know, than Vasil, but I think that gap is relatively marginal because Vasil ends up finding himself nibbling. Hamel has an above average heater, above average carry. The velocity is closer to average, but he gets above average carry, and it's a flat VAA. So he gets even more swings and misses than you'd expect. Like it does play up. And that's why I think it's an easy 55 there. Then the changeup already flashes above average, and I think that's a pitch that's going to play at the big league level. And the slider is comfortably average. I have a little bit more faith in his ability to mix in that curveball, and then he'll use that cutter here and there as well. I'd like to see that command tick up a little bit more. Yeah. But ultimately, you've got, I think, the arsenal of a solid back end of the rotation starter. I could see a number four here because of the quality of the fastball. I think that it wouldn't shock me if that fastball plays closer to a plus pitch because of the approach angle and the fact that it's sitting more 93, 94 and gets 18, 19 inches of ride. I like the characteristics. I think the fastball slider changeup is good enough as is to be a back end of the rotation starter. And then he mixes in that cutter and curveball. Probably a five, but I could dream on a four, you know, an average four there. Probably settles in as a solid five. And, you know, that's what kind of gives him the edge here.
Dude, I can't stand AAA. Like, I don't understand what's going on. Dominic Hamel has walked 10 in 13 innings. Like, is it the full ABS? What's going on here? Because I see those numbers everywhere. Like, David Festa, brutal walk numbers already this year. And, you know, it's really like, it takes a special command type guy to not be walking 5 per 9 in AAA. So what I will say is you open up the walk numbers and you tense up your shoulders and you say, ooh, like, are we sure this guy's not finding the strike zone at all? I have no idea how to explain to you why everybody's command ticks that far down in AAA. And I've been here for now 2.5 years. I don't know why. And
it's weird.
I wouldn't lean too far into, oh, he got up to AAA and he can't throw a strike to save his life. I think it's a combination of the ABS system being very hitter friendly, and I don't know what the other pieces that go into it are, but those walk numbers are misleading.
Aren't they doing the ABS on the weekend? What's the ABS?
No, they do. So they do full ABS. So if a guy starts Tuesday through Thursday, they really get screwed. Because that's okay. The full ABS system. The challenge system, which is the thing I think eventually makes its way into Major League Baseball, it's way better, is Friday through Sunday. So Tuesday through Thursday starts, you might see a guy that is plus command walk 6 and be like, what's happening here?
Yeah. So that's the interesting thing is Hamel, first outing of the year, 2 2/3, 7 walks.
Yeah.
Like then he follows that up with 5 innings, 2 runs, 1 walk, 10 Ks. And he follows that up, and that was against Worcester, and then follows that up against Charlotte. 5 1/3, 2 runs, 2 walks, 6 Ks. So this man walks 7 in his first outing, has walked 3 cents in his subsequent 10 in a third inning. So the good news is he seems to have turned the page on that 7 walk outing. But you're seeing the swing and miss there on another level. I was actually almost more encouraged by the fact that he could turn the page on a 7 walk outing, come back out and punch out 10 and walk 1, and then come out again and have another solid outing. The fastball command just hasn't really been there for him, though, in the early parts of this year. He's dominated with the slider and has been locating it. And the changeup has been playing really well also. So that's what's been interesting to me is, like, those pitches are playing really well. Like, that slider might even be playing as an above-average pitch. The changeup looks like at times it could even be a little bit better than an above-average pitch. So I think the arsenal's there. It's just going to be a matter of consistency. And I wouldn't be surprised if he gets an option – or gets a look after Christian Scott, so sometime this year. But what I like is he can definitely fall back on the reliever aspect a little bit more than Vasil. Like if he moves to the pen, that fastball play like plus, and that slider will play above average, and he can mix in the changeup. But I feel confident that he can settle in as a back end of the rotation arm.
Gotcha.
Number 8 or 9, excuse me, Jeremy Rodriguez shortstop prospect who should be playing in the complex this year, came over in the Tommy Pham trade. And this was a rare instance, I think, of the Mets now flipping the script, right? Like not trading away their young, complex, lower-level guys and actually snatching some from some other teams. Rodriguez signed for $1.25 million. I was kind of surprised that, you know, Arizona was willing to move him. I get it that they felt like they could make a push, and Pham ended up playing a good part in that. But Rodriguez looks like he could be a really nice piece here. Great feel to hit. I think a hit tool that's going to project, you know, to plus. It's going to progress to plus. Makes a ton of contact. We saw that already. He is very wiry and like very he's not a very big guy. So I do wonder how much power is there. There's room for more. And I think he can grow into more. But right now it is very slap the ball around the yard. That said, there's such a good feel for the barrel, such a polished swing, and some good actions in the infield. There could be an everyday player here. There's a lot of, you know, things that need to iron out and everything. But when you have the potential for a plus hit tool and already good plate discipline and could potentially stick it short if he moves to second, I think he could be a great defender there. I'm excited. I want to see him fill out a bit more. And if he does, there's an everyday middle infielder here.
That's really cool. Game power. It's very rare that you see a two leading a grade, right? It's probably one guy every third system, every fourth system. How can you dream on a 15-point jump in grade from like a 25 to a 40 with this guy? You just think that turns into 6'1", 200?
Yeah, you know, he's 17. He was 16 at the start of last year. He's 6'1". 170 pounds. And I think that's generous, to be honest. And when I was watching the video of him hitting, he's got that, I can get to anything. I'm going to slap it around the yard. Why would he try to get his A plus swing off? It's a fly out. Yeah. It's a fly out to deep right. I saw it. He had a bunch of A plus swings that were a fly out to deep right. So 2-0 instead, what he was doing most of this season that I saw was, all right, 2-0, I'm going to get a cookie. I'm going to hit a line drive back up the middle, or I'm going to split the gap. But I see a swing path, and I see enough bat speed that I do think he can grow into more power. 40 might be a little generous, but I just, when I see a swing that's already that advanced, there is some room in that frame. If he fills out more and then starts actually being able to leverage hitters' counts more, he backspins pretty well already to the pull side. He snuck several home runs out, and to sneak some home runs out when you legitimately have minimal impact, I think is a testament just to the way that he's able to, you know, generate that spin and generate that carry. And I mean, he elevates. And I think that's the part that really sold me is 30% ground ball rate at the DSL. If he is putting up fringy EVs, but elevating the way that we've seen and mixing in those hard line drives, like right now, everything has just been line drives in the air and just kind of shooting balls in the air in the gaps, but he has not really tried to hit fly balls. So the fact that he can control and hit so many line drives and keep the ball off the ground, if he just adjusts a little bit more as he starts to hit the ball harder, I do think he can grow into that like 40 grade power at least.
Got you. It's funny because for a fan base who like Tyler Naquin is a curse word to the Mets fan base. I just think this guy should feel like a breath of fresh air for Mets fans, especially after dealing Hector Rodriguez and Jose Acuna for Tyler Naquin.
No doubt. Last thing I'll say on Rodriguez. I mean, it's rare that we're going to push DSL guys this high unless they really, really stand out. And like, there's some things that really, really stood out with him. 91% in zone contact rate, 85% contact rate, but then also running one of the lowest chase rates at the complex, you know, at the DSL or the complex league, walking as much as he struck out and then still mixing in, you know, enough impact. That's the thing that, you know, really stands out to me. So I'm very interested to see what the power ends up looking like, but even if it's 30 grade power, I still think he could be an everyday player because of the way that he walks, because of the contact ability, and you know, just spraying line drives and not putting the ball on the ground very often. But if he leans into a little bit more juice, this guy could be a top 100 prospect, and it's going to be fun to monitor this year.
Cool.
Number 8, Colin Houck, the first round pick of the Mets this past draft. He's fun. He's athletic. Shortstop. I think you can dream on average or better tools across the board. He was a 3-star quarterback and had some legit offers you know, out of high school, now fully focusing on baseball. And I think that's going to help him a lot. I like the swing components. You know, it just seems like he looks like a guy that has not, it's kind of like similar to the Carson Williams conversation that we had, where it's just, you can just tell that baseball wasn't maybe on the forefront of his priorities because he was just doing so many other things because he's a sick athlete. I think there's good swing components, but there just doesn't seem to be that comfort and repetition and just, it doesn't look like something he's been doing that long, which I get, you know, is fully focused, but I think we're starting to see some flashes of him settling in. I think you can dream on above average defense at short, above average speed, average power, average or better hit. And that's an everyday middle infielder as well. 6'2", 200 pounds. I think it's just kind of figuring out how to lean into his power a bit more. And I think that's going to come after he gets more comfortable just repeating his moves in the box and making more consistent contact. But so far, you know, I think he's been pretty decent in that regard.
So he had an Arkansas offer to play quarterback, and it didn't come from like an assistant quality control coach. It came from Kendall Briles, who was the offensive coordinator. So like, he was a very good quarterback. And we've talked about it a couple times, I think, on this show. Like, I'm a sucker for the high school quarterback, the good high school quarterback that's playing a position. And, you know, you can see that in a hitter. Obviously, you can see it in a pitcher, right? Like Bubba Chandler, really accomplished high school quarterback. But there's something about the athleticism that playing quarterback and playing a good quarterback takes. And you can see that from Houck. He, you know, like the field grade, you've got 55. I very confidently, having, you know, not dove into a play-by-play of each defensive rep that he's taken like you have, can say I'm confident in him reaching that 55 on the field tool because that guy has been throwing off balance since he was, what, 10 years old? So he knows how to do it. He knows how to move his body. He knows how to manipulate his body in order to get the best possible outcome. The body awareness of a guy that was very good at another sport bodes so well in baseball.
I'm with you. And I think that's exactly what I saw defensively, short thrown from different angles. The footwork was already pretty darn good. And, you know, if he, for whatever reason, did move to third, I think he'd be a plus defender there. The swing and miss has really crept in over the last week. And I really do think that it's part of him adjusting and tinkering. Like he's, I think, you know, I don't know if they're too hell bent on results right now in low A. And I see a guy that's kind of playing around with feels, and that's going to result in him getting blown up a little bit right now. Yeah. And he has been. I have some concerns about just, again, if he can settle in and look more hitterish. I mean, right now he's not looking too hitterish. If you slow-mo and boil down the components of the swing, it looks pretty good. But then when you watch it in real time, it looks a little mechanical.
Is he point A to point B? Like, is it okay?
He looks like a guy that's focusing on his moves and trying to do the things that he's working on in the cage, right?
You're like, not going to succeed like that.
Yeah. No. And look, I think it'll come. I just think Houck's a guy that fans are going to have to be patient with, but he's number eight because of what I think can come when he starts to settle in, but acknowledging that there's some risk here for sure.
Yeah.
Number seven, one of my favorite, like non-top 100 arms to watch when he's on, Blade Tidwell. Right-handed pitching prospect, also in AAA, second round pick in 2022. You can kind of easily see now why Tidwell is ahead of the other guys. And it's because there's two pitches here that start with a six. Right? You get the fastball that's a 60. You get the slider that's a 60. He mixes in a cutter that's average. And then he's got that curveball and changeup as well. You'll see similar arsenals that the Mets kind of have their guys with as well. It's a lot of fastball, slider, cutter. And then, especially for the guys that can't really find the changeup and curveball. And it seems to be a lot of guys that are more on that, I guess, supination route and just can't quite get the changeup going the same way. But Tidwell will flash some good changeups. And that's why I could dream on an average changeup. And if that happens, you've got four average pitches and potentially two plus. His command is probably a little bit behind the other two. But when you're 6'4", 205, you've got a mid-90s fastball that is starting to get more vert and a plus slider. At the end of the day, it's all about the stuff. And he's just got – his stuff's on a different level than the other guys that we've talked about in Vasil and Hamel. Tidwell, I think, is – you know, aside from who we're going to talk about a little bit later, who we've been talking about a ton, Tidwell has the best chance, I think, at being anything more than a back into the rotation starter of those three. And I think it's by a fair margin, just from a stuff perspective.
And it seems like he's going to have no problem with right-handed hitters moving forward because he's figured out the way his hand turns and he's going to be fine. The question is, what pitch is going to get lefties out? And what pitch do you know off the dome? Like, what pitch he's going to get lefties out? Because the arsenal screams righty-righty matchups are hell in a cell. And then righty-lefty is, you know, where he could run into issues. I'd be worried about lefty power bats against him because everything's kind of moving the same way. But righty-righty, zero problems.
Yeah, no, so it's funny. I think that's where the cutter development is helpful because the changeup just being so inconsistent, he's been going to that cutter more than the changeup to lefties and actually has had success with it. So,
and do you have a heat map? I bet he's elevating it.
Yeah, so let me look right now. A little of both, but he's definitely elevating it. He's pretty much sprayed it all over, which is cool because he's got some chases at the bottom, but then I don't have a heat map. I have like a dotted map.
Yeah.
And I'd say it's skewing upwards for the most part. So yeah, he is elevating it. And it's working because you're worrying about a riding fastball and then he can kind of cut from that and get you at the top, but still also comfortable mixing in at the bottom. I would love to see that changeup progress, but it's just nice to know that if it's not there for him, that he can still make another pitch against lefties and not just be so fastball dependent.
Yeah. He makes the top 25 prospects on the all name list. I'll put together the all name list at some point. It might be like, I don't know, all-star break type thing. I'll put together like the all name top 100 prospects, and Blade is a sick one. So shout out Blade.
My mistake, by the way, too. Double A still, not in
Double A. Yet. He'll be there very, very soon. Like very if somebody soon. Goes up, he's the first guy up, and he's been shoving in Binghamton at this point. So you've got Triple A here. You're gonna go and change it, and in 2 days, you're gonna need to bump it back.
Yeah, that's the thing. I might just leave it. Five innings his last time out. 3 hits, 10 Ks. What I'm liking so far though is 5 walks through 10 and 2/3. I know that's not perfect. But if he's 2 to 3 walks every single outing, he's going to miss enough bats to be fine. He's not a guy that's going to give up a ton of hard contact. We saw him last year. Again, when he's on, it's crazy. 4 different outings where he struck out at least 10. He struck out 11 in back-to-back outings last year. I really started to get excited about him when I caught him in the backfields 2 years ago and just seeing the way that he was mixing the fastball, the slider. And at that point, he was throwing some good changeups. The changeup has not been there for him so far this year. Fastball and the cutter. Combined strike rate is 71%, but the slider, 58%, changeup, it's been really bad. And the curveball, it's been really bad. So it might be a fastball cutter slider mix, which is unique, but we've seen guys make that work. And I think his stuff is good enough to potentially make that work. Okay. Number 6, Brandon Sproat, right-handed pitching prospect with the High A Brooklyn Cyclones for now. Talk about stuff, Jack. This is some crazy stuff. He can really rip it. And with Sproat, the big question is the command. Is he going to be able to throw enough strikes? Because when you look at the pitches, it's exciting. Like you could dream on a number 2 starter potentially. But the problem is the command could take him out of being a starter completely. And that's what we've seen. What really got me excited about Sproat was there was some, you know, I think the fastball was kind of shape-wise left something to be desired at points in college. I think he kind of struggled to kill horizontal and kind of blended a 4-seamer and a 2-seamer. Now we're seeing some more true ride. And then he's also got this slider that looks really good, this changeup that could be better than plus, and then a curveball that he mixes in as well. We're talking about 3 potentially plus pitches, at least 3 above average pitches, and a 4th that can be average. I mean, Sproat has a chance to be really nasty. It's just, is he going to throw enough strikes?
The story in baseball this year has been the velocity obsession. And college baseball last year was as fun as it's been in recent memory. Skeens was throwing 100. Brecht was throwing 100. Burns was throwing 100. You had a couple of random bullpen pop-up arms that were throwing 100. Sproat's the forgotten one that hit 101, and he was a starter at Florida. And the Jack Caglione obsession hit full throat last year, right? Spring of 23, And then you had Hurst and Waldrop and that split. Don't forget about Sproat, who hit 101 again. Like, he was buried somehow in the college baseball lore, and he shouldn't have been buried. Commands the question, but 101 is 101. And the fact is, like, he's going to throw some pitches that are going to make an entire crowd go, oh.
Yeah. Yeah. And the thing that gets me the most amped is that the fastball shape being improved, because again, it was flirting with the dead zone a lot. And I think struggling to kind of separate the four seamer and the two seamer, and Hoth mix in two seamers plenty now, but now he has this four seamer that looks like it could be an easy plus pitch. He's getting 17 inches of vert from a 5-6 release height, which is above average ride now. And that was the surprising part last year, was in college, I think opponents hit over 300 against Sproat's fastball. So now he's really overpowering guys with that fastball. And because he can get the two-seamer to get that early ground ball weak contact, and then buzz the four-seamer at the top to get guys out. So being able to do both of those, I think, is really helpful. One, from a command perspective, because, you know, when you're a strikeout guy and you struggle with command, it's going to be even more difficult, because you want to get those early contacts, ground balls, early AB, just roll over and keep the pitch count down. I think we saw him do that a little bit more in the last outing. He walked 5 in his first outing, 2 2/3, no runs, 5 walks, 5 Ks. Second time out, 4 innings, 1 run on a homer, 2 walks, 5 Ks. You have a chance here to have a plus fastball, a plus changeup, and an above average slider and a decent curveball. But I do have concern about whether he's going to be able to locate those secondaries enough. I can put the fastball shape thing to bed, which I'm really excited about now, having those two variations. I think it's going to make him really, really effective. And he's been pounding the zone, honestly, with the fastballs for the most part. But the question is, you know, can he throw more strikes with the changeup, curveball, and slider? And so far this year, it's been rough. It's been 2 starts, but that's going to be the difference between him being a starter and being a reliever.
He's his own competition. He's the guy that's going to dictate when he moves up to double, because it's clear that no hitter in high A is going to match up with him.
No, you might clip a fastball. That's probably it. Fine. No, it's really walks and, you know, walks and clipping a fastball if you're going to be Brandon Sproat.
Like, one guy has beaten him through 2 outs. Yeah,
exactly. All right, number 5, Ryan Clifford, outfielder / first baseman, power guy, came over in that Verlander trade. We talked about it at the time, and that's really where the money came in and was so helpful to get Drew Gilbert, who we'll talk about, and Ryan Clifford. Really impressive. Clifford off to a slow start this year. Not too worried about it. He's hitting the ball really hard. He's had some bad batted ball luck. The classic 80 to 100 point discrepancy between the stats and the X stats. He is hit some balls hard. We saw him on the backfields look good. He's going to whiff. Like, that's going to come with the territory. Yeah. But I think he's going to make a little bit more contact than people would expect from a power guy of his stature. I don't think that the strikeout rate is going to be 33% when we look at the end of the year. It is nice to see him walking more. He's been more selective, something that was a little bit inconsistent last year. Defensive home is a question. He's played a little bit of left. He's played a little bit of right. He's played a little bit of first base. I think it'd be better for his profile if he could be an average corner guy. Has a good arm, really good arm. So I'd like to see him in right ultimately. But the last few games, he's not been striking out nearly as much. I think he's starting to settle in. If he can have that versatility, you know, okay, he's a fringy defender at first and in the outfield. I'd rather him be fringy at both. So then you know, he's not clogging the lineup as much, and you can still, you know, mix and match and be creative, and you can rotate him through 3 spots, that DH, corner, outfield, and first base. I think that's going to be really beneficial. He's still just 20 years old. I think there's even more power in the tank. I mean, this guy realistically could be a 40 home run threat if it all comes together. And that's why he's a top 100 prospect for us, despite almost no defensive value and some hit tool questions. But I think the hit tool questions are not as bad as, you know, you're used to seeing from guys of his power stature at his age.
I think anybody that has played baseball, I mean, dude, even slow pitch softball, knows the type of hitter that Ryan Clifford is. It's the one where if you're at second base, you want to put your toes on the outfield grass. And yes, at first base, like, you're scared. I think that's who Ryan Clifford can be. And yeah, pull side, like, beware of Ryan Clifford. You've got outfield. Is he a first baseman or can he play right?
I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt of I think he can get by in the outfield. And I think they're going to give him every look. I don't think it's going to be great. But when you have a plus-plus arm and he's athletic enough to catch the balls he should be catching.
We've seen coordinated defenders make a home in a corner outfield spot because they can hit the way they can and because they have the hose that they do.
Exactly. I don't think he'd be a liability. But then again, like if you have a better corner outfield option and you have a lineup that you can mix and match with, the fact that he can also play first, I think, is helpful. I want to see him in right with that arm. And I think with just getting more reps out there, they were splitting him, I think, too much. I'm glad that they're playing him more in the outfield now instead of he was getting a lot of first base looks last year. I think it's good to try him in the outfield. He can always go back to first, but I think he can be at least a passable defender in a corner with the arm to kind of put him over the top to average.
Got you.
Number four, Luisangel Acuna, guy you got to see a little bit of with me on the backfields as well when you were down in Florida. And he scorched one. He had a couple bad ABs and then absolutely scorched one to right field. What I love is with Luisangel Acuna, you look at him and you're like, oh, he's not that big. Power is not going to be a huge part of his game. He is a compact guy. But he'll smack a line drive real hard.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden it's like, whoa, he can run into some baseballs. I don't think he's ever going to elevate enough to be, you know, a guy that's going to hit more than 10 to 15. But the fact that he hits balls on the ground so hard and line drive so hard, I think it's going to help him from a BABIP perspective. He's off to a slow start in AAA, but he's just turned 22 like a month ago. And it's a big jump for hitters that, you know, I think rely on bat to ball and are aggressive. And that's what Acuna is. He hits the ball hard. He's aggressive, but he makes a lot of contact. He's a good enough defender to play shortstop, but they have that Lindor guy at the big
level. Yeah.
So he's played second where he'd be elite. He's played center where I think he can be pretty good too. I see this, it's a different offensive profile, but it's that like Chris Taylor type where he could be a super utility. Mm-hmm. And I think that takes some pressure off the bat. He's an elite base stealer. I think the super utility role is what Luisangel Acuna settles into. And that's a really valuable player. And I think a guy that, you know, as McNeil ages, I think will be a really helpful piece for the Mets as he gets a little bit more polished with his approach and understanding what he wants to do as a hitter.
Yeah. I remember during spring breakout, we were talking about like what the comp to Ronald should be, what the comp to Big Bro should be. And we were talking about the batted ball profile, because Luisangel Acuna, he was literally born into the comps. Like, he's always going to hear how he measures up to his older brother. And what we said is like, hey, the setup is almost identical, right? The swing path is almost identical. Ronald Acuna hit 40 homers because he hits line drives at 120 miles an hour.
Yes.
Luisangel Acuna is going to hit 10 to 15 homers because he hits line drives at 105 miles an hour consistently. That's still a damn good player. It's not mm-hmm. the best player in baseball. It's unfair to comp him to the best player in baseball, but Ronald is not a guy that like sells out for lift. Like when Ronald's not going, it's a 60% ground ball rate. When Ronald is going, it's still like a 45% ground ball rate, but he's hitting liners hard enough. And Luisangel is going to hit liners because the swing path is identical to Big Bro. And
which is
I'll take a guy with the same swing path as Ronald Acuna Jr.
Yes. If he hits the ball, like if he was hitting, if his 90th percentile was like 101, I'd be like, all right, like, dude, like,
yeah, you
don't try to be like Big Bro. Like, but it's 104 and it's gone up at Easter. And he has made subtle adjustments to elevate a little bit more, knowing that like, hey, I like Albert Pujols used to always say I'm a line drive hitter, not a home run hitter. And he was another guy that, you know, really was kind of on that plane.
I think Pujols has the most double play ground outs in Major League history. Yeah.
Exactly. So guys like that can get away with it because they hit the ball, like you said, harder than anybody else. But Luisangel Acuna, he's going to need to elevate a little bit more, I think, than his brother, or he's going to need to just have an even better just bat to ball field to hit. I think he's already made that adjustment to elevate a bit more, and we saw him cut that ground ball rate last year by 5% and start to make more contact and handle velocity more because he realized, hey, I can't get away with that, you know, I got to be a little bit more perfect than my brother. Cause like Ronald will sometimes be on his front foot, but he has such insane bat speed that he'll still crush a ball. Luisangel is on his front foot a little bit and it's a ground ball to shortstop. So like, it was just the finer moves. I saw him refine that a little bit and the results were more line drives, hitting the ball harder, handling velocity better, not feeling as crowded. And I think that trend's going to continue. I really like what he's got going on. Yeah, I just think it's a question of how much power is he going to tap into. I'm starting to realize that it's probably going to be more gap to gap, but that's okay with everything else he brings to the table.
For sure.
Number three, Christian Scott, who we have talked about plenty on the show over the last couple months, honestly. But Christian Scott, one of the biggest climbers in our top 100 list going into this year. And man, he might have climbed even more if we put the list out a little bit later. I really liked what we saw. You know, I really liked what I saw from him during spring training at the end of last year. We talked about one of the best KWB guys, but then adding that sweeper, what that's done for him, and then seeing what he's done in the early going this year is pretty crazy through three starts. Yes, the ERA is 3.77, but he's thrown 14 and a third innings. He's punched out 26 and he's walked three in AAA so far. What I love is, and then by the way, that's a 46% strikeout rate, 5% walk rate. The only way he's been getting burned right now is by home runs. And, you know, it's two home runs, a home run, and two home runs in the last three outings. This new sweeper that he has added, and he has like the sweeper, and then he has a harder slider as well that's shorter. When he's getting later in the starts, he starts to leave it up a bit more, and that's where a couple of these home runs have come from. I'm not overly concerned about that. He's being stretched out, you know, I think in preparation for a big league start. 82 pitches, 83 pitches, 95 the last time out. Last year, it was the fastball and the changeup that made him so good. It's a really unique fastball from a tough release with great characteristics, and it blew hitters up last year, and that's why we've got the grade that we've got on it as a 65, borderline 70. And then the changeup working off of that was just a problem for hitters. He adds the slider, and so I'm like, oh my gosh, this three-pitch mix is going to be ridiculous. Weirdly, the changeup has not been there for him this year, which is nuts, because last year, again, the slider was the third offering, and the changeup, opponents hit a .174 against with a 19% swinging strike rate and a 40% chase rate almost. Then you go to this year, the slider, he's landing for a strike 74% of the time, with a chase rate of 44% and a swing strike rate of 20%. But the changeup, he's only landed for a strike. He's thrown 35 of them. He's only landed 15 for a strike. When it's in the zone, it's been disgusting. I mean, there's been plenty of swing and miss, in zone whiff, all that good stuff. But it's really unique that he adds the slider and all of a sudden the feel for the changeup dissipates. It was easily a plus pitch last year.
Yeah. It might just be hand turn. Like, I don't know what it is. It might be a feel thing. It's like, hey, he focused so much on turning his hand this way that like he's, I don't know, like not feeling it this way well enough. It's weird. It feels like that's just a pitch that you should have, like no issue. And, you know, if you were throwing it so well at the professional level already, why did it go away? But not worried about it because like he still is carving, and you're right. Yep. It's the homers. I wonder if every run has come from a home run. Do you know? Because it's at least five solo homers. I wonder if one of them was a two-run shot.
I'm fairly positive one was a two-run shot.
Okay, so there you go. Literally all of the run production against him has come from long balls.
Which is, yeah. And like, he's going to keep guys off the bases because he doesn't walk dudes. Yeah. And when that changeup comes, like it's going to come back. When it continues to come back, he's going to be even tougher. So I think that might be the last piece before he gets his big league debut. If that changeup's there, he could be even closer to fringe two.
And the good news, yeah, for sure. And the good news is the Mets have yet to have a rotation piece really falter. Like Quintana's been good. Seve's been great out of nowhere. And then, I mean, Budo's been good. And I think two starts that he's made at this point. The two, I don't even want to call them lame ducks, because like Manaea's got a 4-3 through three starts. Hauser is, you know, classic 5-6-7 starter. If Hauser turns in a couple rough outings and they deem Christian Scott ready, just move Hauser to the pen and Christian Scott has a spot in that rotation. Yep. So we were waiting on somebody to really flounder in that rotation. Nobody's doing it yet, which gives him more time to find that changeup again. And as soon as he finds it, I don't think David Stearns is going to have any issue making that call.
I feel really confident about him being a middle rotation arm. And I think there could be a little bit more than that. The fact that he's dominating in AAA without his best out pitch last year.
Yeah.
Like that's pretty nuts. And again, I just absolutely love this fastball. Into the top two, Number two, Drew Gilbert, also coming over from the Astros in that trade with Ryan Clifford for Justin Verlander. Gilbert, it's just good across the board. Like, it's just one of those where nothing jumps off the page. There's nothing that's going to blow your mind, but it's above average across the board. You're going to have above average field to hit, above average plate discipline. The power I'm hoping is above average, but it might, game power may settle in at average. Plus runner, above average defense and center, hits lefties. Like, there's, it's really hard to poke a hole in Drew Gilbert's game.
We talked about Drew Gilbert in the same way that we were talking about a lot of those well-rounded guys within the top 100, and we clumped Gilbert in with Tommy Troy and, you know, maybe even like, it's reaching high, but a Cole Young, like those kind of guys. They just do everything well to the point where they're top 100 prospects. And, you know, you see guys in AA that are, you know, number 15 prospects in systems or, you know, top 20 prospects in systems that do everything solid. And they're just like good all around ball player. This guy's the best of the all around ball players that we have in minor league baseball, where everything is a 55 or a 60, which is hard to find. Like, you can find guys with 45s across the board, which is a good player and a guy that like may backdoor his way into a debut, but this is different. And this is a unique blend of all around ability.
Well, especially when, and you have those types of players, that's where I really love the makeup side, just putting them over the top. And Drew Gilbert is gamer of all gamers, like plays at 100 miles an hour. And when you're above average, average above average across the board, and then you play at 100 miles an hour and do all the little things, everything just is bumped up even more. So that's why I see him translating really well.
Exposed. There's not a deficiency exposed when you do that. The tooled out guys, when they operate at 100 miles an hour, sometimes they have a shortcoming exposed. And that's when they strike out a bunch or like it almost feels like they're pressing. I don't think you'll ever see a Drew Gilbert look like he's pressing.
No. No, it's like maximizing those tools, but not, you know, playing out of control. And that's why I really like Gilbert. And not off to the best start in AAA, but you know, he's been pushed pretty quickly. And you know, I think he's going to settle in. Probably another guy that makes his debut sometime this year, I'd imagine. Depends on what the Mets do. I think that, you know, they may clear some space by making a trade here or there, because right now it's a little busy and they're playing pretty well. But if they do end up clearing some space, Gilbert's probably a guy that I could see getting up there. The pull side power is probably closer to above average, and I think he's a guy that can end up leveraging his counts enough. And the EVs are 103.5 mile per hour, 90th percentile. Like, I think if he leverages his hitter's counts the right way, he could probably hit it, you know, run into 20 a little bit more. But even if he's 15, I think he's going to hit a lot of doubles. He's going to get on base at a pretty good clip and has a good feel to hit. Number one, Jett Williams, infielder, still playing shortstop, but put him at second because like that's where I think he ends up. He's the top prospect in the system because he is a little bit of everything that kind of we said about Drew Gilbert, but I think even more explosive. I mean, he is a plus runner borderline. Like, I have a 60, but I'm starting to think we might need to bump that to a 70 with some of the run times I've seen from him. He walks with the best of them. He's off to a little bit of a slow start himself too, but even his slow start, right? He's walked five times, struck out five times. We know the chase rate's always going to be below 20%. He packs a punch for a 5'7 guy. He can, I think, run into 20 home runs as well. He's going to spray the ball over the field. I think he can end up being that super utility type too, that plays second, center, left, short if you need it, probably even third if you needed it. But I just think he's another guy at 20 years old, does so many things well. The plate discipline being elite really helps as well. It's just a really solid game all the way around.
Yeah, I mean, and one of the best eyes in minor league baseball, right? Who's got as good an eye as Jett Williams? Holiday did. Got plate discipline. Tamar.
But yeah, I would. I'd take his plate discipline and swing decisions over Tamar. I would.
So it's Holiday, right? That might be it. Harry Ford.
Yeah. Ford probably there too, but he's right in that conversation of like the best plate discipline guys.
70 runner with some of the best plate discipline in the minor leagues.
And he's going to continue to become a better base dealer. And we talked about that in the top 100 episode. But like, we put it 70 on the plate just when I realized that it's the old table that we have on here on the screen right now. So I'll update that. But when you have 70 plate discipline, the plus speed, above average field of hit, I think potential for average power, and you can play all these different positions, like, that's going to be a really fun player. But the plate discipline gives him a higher floor. The speed, I think, gives him a combination of the floor and ceiling. And then the fact that he can have that feel for the barrel and have enough power for that frame, he's just going to be an electrifying table setter. And when you can be a table setter and walk that much, that's going to be a really good player.
All right, close your eyes. Opening day 2027. Jett Williams is playing where defensively?
Center. I want him in center.
Okay.
I know they're not doing it yet.
All right. Luisangel Acuna. Acuna is playing where defensively? Opening day. Second. 27. Okay. Lindor at short. Acuna at second.
But it seems like they might flip-flop that. So I think Jett in a vacuum is better in center because his speed is better used out there. Yeah. But Acuna might just be a better center fielder from what they've seen because they have given Jett Williams some run there. So maybe Jett ends up playing second and Luisangel Acuna plays center. But in a vacuum, I think Jett's best off in center field.
So you're telling me the corner or the up the middle quartet is going to be Francisco Alvarez catching, Lindor and one of Acuna or Jett in the middle infield, and then the other of Acuna and Jett in center field.
Yeah.
Get hyped.
And that's if Drew Gilbert's not in center.
Yeah.
Drew might play left. They have a lot of fun decisions to make.
Get fired up, Mets fans.
Yeah. The system's in a good place. Of course, you can click the article in the episode description. If there's any specific things you want us to cover next week, let us know on YouTube. We're going to continue to do these farm systems going through the NL East, AL Central, and get through the rest of the league. And we'll keep you up with who's performing and some other fun prospect interviews coming up very soon as well. Jack, any final thoughts on this Mets system?
I don't think so. I really like it. And again, like they took a bunch of different routes to get to where they are as a farm system, but they have a top 15 farm system in baseball now. And that's not something that you can say about the New York Mets in the last half decade, at least. So
no,
they're in as good a spot as they've been in when it comes to the farm system in quite a long time. And it took some man in the mirror type moments, but credit to them for seeing that they needed to improve.
Yeah, I'm excited about a lot of these guys, and I think it's a good balance of upside, high probability big leaguers relative to other prospects, and they still got the talent at the big league level too. We'll see if they make some trades too and continue to replenish the system if the team isn't performing. So I think the system could be darn good. That'll do it for this episode. We will talk prospects with you next week. Hope you have a great weekend.